Hey everyone, in this video, we're going to be looking at Chapter 7 of Pragmatic Programmer, which is called While You Are Coding. It's about your brain and what happens when you're programming and the traps you might fall into if you don't infuse your thoughts and words and actions with intentionality. So we'll be covering a few different areas in this chapter across topics such as hacking your subconscious, programming by coincidence or not, how refactoring and testing play into the life cycle of software, and a few other ones like the importance of naming as well. So the first section of the chapter is called Listen to Your Lizard Brain and starts with a quote from Gavin De Becker, which says, "Only human beings can look directly at something, have all the information that they need to make an accurate prediction, perhaps even momentarily make the accurate prediction, and then say it isn't so." What he's talking about, perhaps among other things, is the fact that people rely on their intuition even when their physical senses are telling them otherwise. As you get more and more experienced, you build up a lot of intuition for yourself of things that work and don't work in your day-to-day life, coding patterns and the like. You can't put these intuitions and habits into words necessarily, but they direct how you work and live. It's not a good or bad thing, it's just how we are. It does become problematic in the longer term, because after a while, we get so ingrained in our habits and we miss opportunities to grow. Or maybe we fail to grow and develop ourselves because we're afraid of making mistakes. Although fighting against this mental ossification takes concerted effort over the course of time, the authors also suggest that it's possible to fight against this in day-to-day life by occasionally changing your context, like going for a walk or having lunch with someone. These and others, like talking through problems in depth with yourself or others, are all great ways to get mentally unstuck. They suggest socializing and even getting a drink as possible solutions. The bummer peak is real. The next section is called Programming by Coincidence, which is what we do perhaps more often than we'd expect. Lots of times, I, and probably you, and probably most engineers, write code that does what you want it to do, and then you move on to the next thing. Then you build something new on top of that, and something else on top of that. Soon you have a great, complex program that does all the things, but then eventually it stops working, or some other unintended behavior comes up. The problem is that you don't know why the code is failing because you don't know why it worked in the first place. Things were just happening, and now they aren't. So the authors have a few tips to avoid this situation, which I'll run through quickly here, and they're pretty self-explanatory. First is to always be aware of what you're doing. Be able to explain what your code is to someone who is less experienced than you are. In fact, one of the things I talk about at the end of this chapter is that a mastery of spoken language is basically a prerequisite to programming well, because if you can't organize your thoughts in a way that is approachable to others, you won't be able to teach them. And or the code won't be self-explanatory when it's time for others to work with it. Document your assumptions. Don't just test code, but also test your assumptions. Prioritize your effort. And last but not least, don't be a slave to history. Just because existing code looks or works some way doesn't mean that's how it should necessarily be in the future. This topic in particular is so close to my heart because everywhere you go, you'll see code that seemingly was written by accident, and it does no favors to the people who come after the original author. Writing code in intentionality is honestly philanthropic because you're doing a favor for whoever comes next, and often that person is you. Next is a section called algorithm speed. It's about estimating how long it will take our algorithms to run and uses the term big O notation. Despite the name, this terminology is less lurid than it seems. It is a mechanical way of dealing with approximations, and it puts an upper bound of saying how long something that we're measuring will take as a function of its input's growth. You'll hear terms like constant time or O of one, which means no matter the input, the operation takes the same amount of time. Another is O of n, which means that the time required to run increases in line with the input size. And from there, we have others like O of n squared, which means the time and complexity grows geometrically as the input increases. So it's worth being aware of strategies to cut this time down, because we don't want any O of n squared or worse algorithms out there. That'd be very computationally intensive. One is called binary chop, and this halves the set of items being considered from the input every pass. Another is divide and conquer, which divides an input into two halves and solves both simultaneously. Moving on from there, we're talking about refactoring. Lots of times, software development is made analogous to construction. I do it myself a lot, particularly when pulling analogies from the Mythical Man Month book. But it's more like sowing and harvesting in the context of gardening. People like to use the construction analogy because it's visually easy to think about. A brick goes in here, some masonry and pipes go in here, stained glass windows go over here, and when you're done, you have a beautiful cathedral. But the truth is that it's a lot more complicated than that, and this is where the gardening analogy comes in. Gardens are more freeform, and part of the jazz of gardening is that every year or every season, you revisit what you've made and make changes depending on your goals for the future or what nutrients need to be restored to the soil. This is where refactoring comes in. After a while, software gets stale. You can almost tell with your intuition when you look at a part of a code base that's old. The thing is that refactoring isn't a once in a while thing. If you only refactor once a year or so, the garden of your code base will get unruly and weedy really quickly. Rather, the authors say you should refactor when you've learned something, when you understand something better than you did last year, yesterday, or even just 10 minutes ago. I love this quote because if you follow it, you'll be improving not just your code base, but also yourself as you're applying and practicing what you've learned. In the real world, people are tempted to not refactor because it takes time and projects are on a deadline. The reality is, however, that lack of intentionality in refactoring leads to an accumulation of tech debt, which would take longer to untangle than if the time was invested along the way to improve. Consider, for example, a code base that had gone years without being refactoring and is so hard to understand that people are scared to work with it because it's so complex. At that point, the entire app has to be thrown away and rewritten as a plethora of microservices. It's not theoretical. I've seen it and instances like it throughout my career, and you probably have too. Next is a section called Test to Code, and as the name implies, it's about the importance of writing tests for your code. The first thing that the authors highlight up front is that testing is not about finding bugs. The benefit of tests, as they say, isn't really about what happens when you run them, but when you write them. Now, tests are obviously valuable when you run them because they verify if the code is working as expected and not working as not expected. But why would they be valuable when you write them? The answer essentially lies in the fact that to be able to write tests for a program, the program itself has to be understandable enough for its behavior to be recorded and documented by way of the assertions of tests. Beyond that, a test is basically the first user of your code, and it's an ongoing user as well. The authors talk about test-driven development, which is a methodology that basically says when you want to add behavior to your code base, write a test that describes it, and then write the code that makes the test pass. This kind of habit is a worthwhile use of time to a degree, but often people find themselves getting decreasing marginal utility if they try to apply it to their entire job all the time. The next section is called property-based testing. This section is relatively drawn out, but essentially purports that computers should be doing the testing, since if you're the author of both a program and a test, you might build false assumptions in both places. So what they mean by the computer should be doing the testing is this concept called property-based testing. Property-based testing entails libraries that generate different inputs automatically, like the Python library hypothesis, which comes up with its own inputs and then runs tests repeatedly, passing in a different of the generated ones each time. Humorously, or maybe ominously, the next section is called Stay Safe Out There, and it talks about the need for thoughtfulness and security as a part of a software's design. They suggest 5 principles for achieving this. The first is minimize attack surface area. Next is the principle of least privilege. Next is secure defaults. Next is to encrypt sensitive data. And last is to maintain security updates. Minimize attack surface area basically means that simpler software should prevail over more complex when possible, because the fewer complexities there are to accomplish a goal, the fewer possible openings for attack from bad parties will be available. Input data, unauthenticated and authenticated services, output and debugging info are all attack vectors as well. The last section of the chapter is called naming things, and this is also a topic that's particularly close to my heart, because good naming brings clarity to the purpose of functions and other behaviors in your software if done well. And so I always try to put concerted effort into creating names that are accurate, specific, and intuitive. If you have a function that's missing any of these qualities, you'll run the risk of not having a way of knowing what the original purpose of a function was when you come back to it later. Think about the function name getTotal. You'd have some idea of what it does, getting the total of something, but you wouldn't really know if you were right, and you could only judge its behavior based on that name. By contrast, something like getCartSubtotal would be much more specific and much more constrained in its usage, to the point where you can be confident wherever you need to use that function, since the behavior and what it does to what object is all in the name. You should have a mastery of the spoken language and then of the written one, and take that same inclination towards clarity in the naming of software and not just the efficiency of it. Intentionality, here and elsewhere, honors the craft. If you watch a Fabergé jeweler, or if you watch a master sculptor engaging in their crafts, you see people who have spent so much time practicing, and you'll see people who aren't really on autopilot, despite sometimes having to do something repetitive for a living. But they're really engaging their head and heart along with their hands and feet, and this doesn't happen by accident. So that's all for this one. My name is Daniel, and I make programming-related videos, sometimes coding tutorials, and others more abstract, like book chapter summaries. I do it not only because I love teaching you, but I love learning for myself as well. So if you found this video and this series helpful or thought-provoking, I'd appreciate a like, subscribe, and comment. I love hearing from you, and we'll see you all in the next one.